wa Yoweri Kaguta Museveni ku bwa pulezidenti. Mu kusaba kuno, bannamateeka ba Kyagulanyi baagala kukyusa mu mpaaba yaabwe, babeeko ne bye bongeramu kubanga bafunye obujulizi oluvannyuma lw'okufuna obujulizi obumala oluvannyuma lw'okufuna obujulizi obupya. Kyokka bannamateeka ba Yoweri Kaguta Museveni basabye kkooti egoba okusaba kwa bano nga bagamba nti eky'okukyusa mu mpaaba eno kyakukereyesa omusango guno okutandika okuwulirwa. Bannamateeka ba Museveni bagamba nti obudde obuweebwa okuwulira omusango guno butono nnyo, kale nga tekyetaagisa kukyusa mu mpaaba. Kyokka bannamateeka ba Kyagulanyi bo bagamba nti omuntu waabwe yasibwa mu maka ge ennaku 10, kyokka ng'amateeka gawa omuntu ennaku 15 okukuŋŋaanya obujulizi nga y'ensonga lwaki beetaaga okukyusa mu mpaaba, kubanga obudde balina butono ate nga kati bafunye obujulizi obulala bwe beetaaga okwongera mu musango guno. Katubirabe.
This honorable court to decide these matters once and for all. My lords, I beg to submit immediately that we oppose this application to amend the presidential election petition number 1 of 2021 that was filed in this honorable court on the 1st of February, because it lacks merit on all grounds, and we shall proceed to illustrate to you why, my lord. The current position on this matter is that indeed the presidential election petition was filed on the 1st of February 2021. And according to the presidential election petition's rules, the next and only step to be carried out was the filing of the respondent's answer to the petition. My lords, the third respondent at least duly complied with the rules by filing our answer and serving the answer to the petitioner on the 4th of February, 2021. It is the contention of the third respondent that these issues, the following issues that I wanted to point out to you, should be sufficient to resolve these matters. The first issue, my lord, is whether or not the civil procedure rules apply to the amendment of the petition. That's the first issue, we think. The second one is whether or not an amendment can be brought after the expiry of time. The third issue would be whether or not the amendments can be allowed in the manner in which they are in, because we are trying to say that a new cause of action cannot be brought at all. With your permission, my lord, the Chief Justice, together with the Justices of the Supreme Court, I will submit on the first and second points. The petition has come to this honorable court under sections 98 and 100 of the Civil Procedure Act that provide as follows. And by the way, while I was still discussing the election petition number 1 of 2016, the recommendations by the Supreme Court to the Attorney General were taking into consideration the fact that the petitioners then were complaining about the lack of sufficient time. The recommendations which were enacted recently, the Attorney General followed the recommendations of the Supreme Court and went ahead to ensure that these recommendations were abided, and these recommendations resulted into the extensions of time. For example, the day of holding a new election if the current one is annulled, the time of presentation of your petition. Of course, sadly, the only thing that was not increased was the time for the reply by the respondent. Sadly, but nonetheless, we complied, which was the 3 days that we are all aware of. Now, my lords, as I was saying, the petition has come to this honorable court under sections 98 and 100 of the Civil Procedure Act, which provide as follows. The 98, saving of the inherent powers of the court, they said, nothing in this act shall be deemed to limit or otherwise affect the inherent power of the court to make such orders as may be necessary for the ends of justice or to prevent abuse of the process of court. That is 98. Then 100 talks about the general power to amend. The court may at any time, and on such terms as to costs or otherwise, as it may think fit, amend any defect or error in any proceeding in a suit, and all necessary amendments shall be made for the purposes of determining the real question or issue raised by or depending on such proceeding. Further, my lords, the petitioner seeks to move the honorable court principally under Order 6, Rules 19 and 20 of the CPR. Rule 19, my lord, is as follows. and that is about amendment of bidding. The court may at any stage of the proceedings allow either party to alter or amend his or her pleadings in such manner and on such terms as may be just, and all such amendments shall be made as may be necessary for the purpose of determining the real questions in controversy between the parties. You see, as it is there, it looks appealing that it says of determining the real questions in controversy between the parties. Except as I will demonstrate later, it cannot apply. Then Rule 20, the plaintiff may amend without leave. And this one says the plaintiff may, without leave, as my learned colleagues here purported to do, amend his or her plaint once at any time within 21 days from the date of issue of the summons to the defendant, or where a written statement of defense is filed, then within 14 days from the filing of the written statement. Now, my understanding, my lords, of the applicant's mode of seeking to proceed under this civil procedure rules is based on Rule 15 of the Presidential Election Petitions Rules, which states that, and the subheading is procedure general. Subject to the provision of these rules, the practice and procedure in respect of a petition shall be regulated as nearly as may be in accordance with the civil procedure rules. And the rules made under that act relating to the trial of a suit in the High Court, with such modifications as the court may consider necessary in the interest of justice and expedition of the proceedings. Now, my lords, that being the avenue that they are seeking, it is our submission that this proposed procedure under Order Rule 6, Rule 19 and 20 can only be adopted relating to the trial of the presidential election petition, not to the pleading. And the sections in the Presidential Elections Act bear this out, that section 15. We submit that rules 19 and 20 already cited, relates to amendment of pleadings and not to the trial of a suit at the High Court. And in our opinion, we are not yet at the point of the trial of this petition. We are at the stage right now of filing the pleading. Therefore, this option is not available, my lords, to the applicant or petitioner. The Supreme Court cannot, in our opinion, adopt procedures for the filing of proceedings from the High Court at this stage. My lords, the instant case, which is a petition, presents extremely unique and different circumstances, where the burden is on the petitioner to present his petition and supporting evidence within 15 days from the date, within 15 days from the date of the declaration of the results in accordance with Article 1042 of the Constitution as amended. Now, that article says a petition under Clause 1 of this article shall be lodged in the Supreme Court Registry within 15 days after the declaration of the election results. The reference in issue relates to a different matter of pleading described as a petition, and that necessarily puts very tight time frames on the respondent, as I've already spoken to respond to the petition within 3 days from service of the petition on the respondent. And this is illustrated in Regulation 8.1 of the Presidential Election Rules, Election Petition Rules. That rule, my lords, says if the respondent wishes to oppose the petition, the respondent shall, within 3 days after the petition was served on him or her, file an answer to the petition. In our view, my lords, this is it. It is constitutionally time bound. My lord, it is not in dispute that the actions of filing and serving of all the pleadings by the respective parties referred to under the Presidential Election Petition Rule have all been carried out. That is not in dispute. The petition has been filed and served, and so has the answer. Now, the applicant is now seeking your indulgence to adopt a procedure of amendment of pleadings from a trial process under the Civil Procedure Rules that is much more elaborate and without question involves a much longer process of filing of pleadings and hearing that is not time-bound. While, unlike the most important matter, unlike this most important matter, which due to the importance is bound by very strict timelines, let us suffice it to note that the rules of the presidential elections petition, as amended, under which we are currently operating, provide the petitioner with these 15 days to file his petition, a period which was extended from the 10 days from the amount the court recommended increase the days. So from 10, they were increased to 15 to benefit the petitioner or petitioners that wish to challenge a presidential election. The respondent, as I already said, on the other hand, had only 3 days to respond to all the issues raised in the petition. But maybe this court shall now find it fit to increase the days of the respondent, to recommend an increment in the days for the respondent. And all the respondents have since filed their respective answer to the petition in time. My lords, just imagine, with these deadlines in mind, the prejudice that would be suffered by the acceptance of an application for an amendment after the respondent has presented his whole case. And in this case, as my learned colleagues have alluded to, where there is a completely new cause of action, because the petitioner has now had the advantage of reading my answer and then saying, oh my goodness, perhaps I have something wrong with my petition, or for that matter, I have no petition at all. Let me go back and redo a petition, a new petition. My lords, if you don't mind, I'll just refer you to an authority on this matter. It's authority number 13, table O in the respondent's list of authorities, which I'm requesting that you will adopt, my lords, because we all did one, the three respondents did one matrix for the authority. The authority is number 13, Harmon versus Tyler. My lord, Harmon versus Tyler, Supreme Court of Tennessee, of 1904. It talks about elections and time of filing statements and amended statements by contestants. My lords, I just refer you to in that case on page 1044. When one desires to contest the election of a person, a chancellor or a judge, he must comply with the statutes. The first provision of which requires that within 20 days after the election, a sworn statement of the grounds of contest must be presented to the chancellor of that division. This provision of the statute is mandatory. And as we have seen, jurisdictional. Remember, my lords, I think one of my colleagues already alluded to the fact that in matters presidential election, this is the only court that has jurisdiction because of the importance and because of the potentially dire consequences if there were other courts and then you had to go through appeals, because there are time frames which need to be kept in order to avoid potentially a constitutional crisis. So my lord, this provision is mandatory. It is also in the nature of a statute of limitation and bars all contests which are not begun within the prescribed time limit. We also think, the judge went on to say, that this construction of the statute applies to all amended or indeed any other pleadings making new charges upon which to contest the election with the same force that it does to the original one. So it's the same, almost on all fours with our. Such is its plain meaning and intent. The legislature has made no provision for extension of the time by allowing an amendment, and the law makes none. It considered 20 days sufficient time in which to obtain all your information necessary to begin the contest, and it was ample. In this case, as a contestant says, he knew all the facts when he filed his original bill. My Lord the Chief Justice, I will eventually attempt to to respond to your question about if there is a lacuna and somebody has is suffering a disability, should the court sit back? I will get to that, my lord.
Fine.
Now, my lord, on the following page 105, there is a possibility that if the original contest or a new one by amended or supplemental pleading is to be commenced at any time after the expiration of the time prescribed, then it can be done at any period, because the extensions can be continuous, and the litigation in this way prolonged, such that in such instances, they might be prolonged until the old term of the new term of office now expires. They are saying that if you allow this thing, it can arrive at such an absurdity that you find yourself in December still on the same matter. Now, my lord, I submit that the third respondent will suffer prejudice if this honorable court allows the amendments, because the proposed amendments are intended, in our opinion, to defeat the respondent's answers to the petition as they attempt to respond to the deficiencies raised in the respondent's answer. You see, in our view, it is disingenuous for the petitioner to now come to court seeking your indulgence to amend the petition when, as I've already said, it had more time than the respondent, who has since adhered to the strict timeline of filing the respondent's answer within 3 days from service. Because we could make a similar argument that, look, you had 15 days, it is not unreasonable, my lords, 3 days is too little, we found it was impossible for us to reply, so here we are, we have done it in 7 days. Now, there is a time, of course, within which, under our constitution, you are supposed to have interrogated and even given reasons and arrived at a conclusion, of the petition. Now, we therefore beg this honorable court that in your consideration of the petitioner's prayer for the amendment of the petition, you consider the reality of the issue, that the country is currently awaiting the final confirmation of the presidential election. If the petitioner is given free rein to amend his petition, it then means, I try to explain that the respondent would now then have to file an amended answer, in effect affecting the said time frame under the law, which is in section 59(3) of the Presidential Election Act number 16 of 2015, as amended, for determining the petition. My lords, as I have said, potentially this... Yes, ma'am.
You're now in 27 minutes.
I've just used the 7 minutes.
Yes,
so I have the 20.
Yes, you finished 10 minutes. You're 20 minutes on everyone. You now have 7 minutes. I'm adding 3 to that. So please finish within the
okay.
10 minutes.
Most obliged, my lord. I thought you were saying I'd finished the 7, and I now had the 20. So, my lords, it would potentially blow wide open the door for when this extremely, if this was allowed, for when this extremely important matter ends and can probably leave room, as I've already said, for a constitutional crisis. And in any case, it would render the whole purpose of amendments superfluous, and the fact that the first court, the Supreme Court, already went out of its way to recommend an increment of time. Let us recall, my lords, that under Article 1043 of the Constitution, as amended, it is mandatory for the determination of this matter, together with its findings and reasons, to be in 45 days. It is mandatory. The Supreme Court shall inquire into, and that's section 59(3), and determine the petition expeditiously and shall declare its findings not later than 45 days from the date the petition is filed. My lords, we pray that these considerations are used in your assessment of this matter and finding for the respondents that once the petitioner files a petition, especially under the new rules that give them an expanded time frame, your honorable court finds that they cannot be allowed to amend the petition as filed under the civil procedure rules, as the application in this peculiar circumstance cannot be allowed. My lord, we submit that the amendments being sought cannot be brought after the expiry of this time specified under that constitution and the presidential election rules thereunder. The laws as cited make express provisions for the time frames within which to file the presidential election petition and the answers thereto in mandatory terms. It is the respondent's submission that in the event that the legislators had intended otherwise, then, of course, they would have expressly done so. We therefore pray, my lords, that this court finds that there are no sufficient grounds for amendment of the petition, and the applicants have not satisfied the criteria for the grant of leave by court to amend the petition. Now, because I'm in a hurry, because I have a time constraint, my lords, it is on that premise that I pray that you'll be pleased to dismiss this application with costs to the respondent for having been brought irregularly and without any legal basis. As I might have already said, my lords, I would like to pray that your lordship adopt the matrix on behalf of all the three, the matrix of the authority, on behalf of all the three respondents.
Okay, thank you so much. Pastor Lubega and your team, whoever is, you know the rules about the joint. It's a strict rule. You only have the right of rejoinder if any of the counsel for the three respondents raised any matter which was new, which was not part of your submissions, then you're permitted to respond. And you have 5 minutes for that.
My Lord, did I understand
it? It is not intended to enable you improve on your earlier submission.
Thank you, my Lord.
Can we know what the new matters are? So that we don't begin and then we interrupt you.
First, my Lord, with some difficulty, I think it relates to the issue they have raised on what amounts to trial. The next is prejudice that the application presents to them. And number three is about the applicability of the civil procedure rules away from Order 19, rules 1 to 3.
I thought you submitted on the second and the third, which you raised.
No, my Lord, when I submitted, I referred to Order 1, and their answer has been that those ones are not applicable. What is applicable is Order 19, which regulates affidavits. Thank you, my Lord.
So your 5 minutes begin running now.
Thank you. My Lord, it is not true, as submitted by Land Council for the first and second respondent, that the applicable order is Order 18 and not Order 1, Rules 12. There is sufficient authority, and I find fortification in the reading itself of Order 1, Rule 12.
Kwebaza nogwe munange yakumide ku BBS Telefaina nesobola kutuusaako ensonga ezo zonna wabula ebikyali mu kkooti oludda lwa NUP lwagala kukyusa mu mpaaba ate oludda olwowaabirwadde olukyagaanye nga lugamba nedda